BC TV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features a guest artist who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to New Arts Alive. And with me, I have an amazing Grace. No, I have a very interesting illustrator and writer guest. And so the whole hour will be with her. And the Amazing Grace is the name of her book. And it is a book written and illustrated by our guest tonight, is Joan Reed Treweek. From True Stories Told by Her Mother, Grace Coon Reed.
Right.
And I think that it would be appropriate for you to talk about the formation of your book so that when we go through with some of your settling story.
Okay.
You had fun. I know that.
It was fun. Well, the last thing I ever thought I would do is write a book. I don't consider myself a writer. I have always liked art, but as far as writing, that was not in my thinking at all.
And you're thinking about a second book.
I am thinking I'm being pushed into the second one. The stories keep coming now that this has been done. My mom has always told us stories. I heard them all the time to the point where I didn't hear them anymore. And then as I got older, I started to hear them again. And sometimes I would be visiting her, and when I went to school, because I was a teacher, I would go to school and I would repeat her stories, and they'd say, "That's amazing." And so, "That's amazing, Grace." And so people started to say, you should write a book. Well, I didn't want to write a book. So one of my mom's sisters, a younger sister, Shirley, I can talk about Shirley. She'll be okay if I talk about her. She had this little bit of an obsession about the old homestead. My grandparents moved away from it, sold it to an Amish family, and Shirley just had to get back there somehow. And she asked me if I would paint a picture of the house. So we went to visit it, and the Amish had completely changed it. The inside was still there. When you went in the door, it was the same old house, but outside they had completely changed it. So I had to guess. So I started this painting, and I don't really like landscape and buildings, and so I wasn't sure how I was going to do it. Someone suggested that I do it as a primitive. So that's what I did. So I started the house, and as I was working on it, my mom would say, "Now there, that's where this happened. And this is where Pap ran over Charlie and I had to kick him until he woke up. And this is where the garden was." And this, so she went through. So as she was telling me, I put the little pictures in, little figures to remind me of all her stories. And I think I probably took that painting to school. And someone there saw it and just loved it and started to push me to write these stories down. And I felt like I should, but I didn't know how to. And I thought, well, I can't really write. I didn't know how to write, but I can draw. So I started to illustrate the stories. And from there, I got some help with some of the stories and suggestions for questions I could ask my mom, because I didn't know details. She would say, "This happened." It never occurred to me to say, "Well, how did that make you feel? And what happened after? And what did this person say?" And so I had a little help from some English teachers, actually, that helped me to know what questions to ask my mom to get a little bit more. And that's where it came from. And it's continuing. Once I got it done, now she remembers more things. My brothers and sisters are contributing. And
are they excited about it?
Yeah, they are. They are. I'm not sure how the second one's going to go. There are so many, because there are six of us kids in my family, and there are all kinds of stories. So I'm going to have to, you know, kind of weed them out, because there's just going to be too many of them. So that's how it started.
Could we have you then enter into the book? Because we're going to spend a half hour or so with the book. And so you might show, what image do you want to show?
Well, they're in order. So if Jordan can just go through until I get to one I want to read about, would that be okay?
Okay.
Is that okay? All right. So just leave it there for a second, Jordan, because it looks like I missed one. This is the, I don't know, can I hold this?
There
it is. Okay, there it is. That is the original picture. And I have to tell you, my Aunt Shirley hated it. Absolutely hated it. So I now have done three versions of the painting of the farm, because she didn't like that one and she didn't like the second one, and I'm working on a third one for her. But you can see tiny little figures here and there, and those represent the stories. So next one, and we can just go, this is where Mary comes into the picture. My mom is in the cradle. Mary was the sister who caused a lot of trouble for my mom. Okay, you can do the next one. Here she is in school. She had no shoes. She only wore rubber galoshes, but no shoes. So that's what that is, and nice little picture of Mary. And this one is on the way. I could probably read this one if that's okay.
Okay.
This is called The Owl. One morning while walking to school, Grace noticed a little screech owl sleeping near the fence row. What a pet this could be. She carefully picked it up and placed it in her school bag. When she got to school, she gently hung her bag in the coat room. The children were quietly working on their lessons. Then the little owl woke up. Panic broke out as the owl swooped around the room. What chaos as teacher, children, and Al all did their best to get away. Finally, the frantic teacher sent for Jean Henry, Grace's cousin, who happened to live nearby. Jean came at once and was able to capture the frightened Al, but the sighs of relief soon turned to screams of horror as Jean picked up the axe resting against the woodpile and without a second thought chopped off the little owl's head. So much for a pet. Okay, we can go to another one. Next one. She went to school with the Amish, so they were in the same one-room schoolhouse as she was in. This story, The Outhouse, gives you an idea of some of the things that she had to put up with. And when I asked her about how old she was, she thought maybe 10 to 12. So that's the age. A lot of these stories are when she's 10 to a young teenager. The Outhouse. Like many households in their area, the Coons family did not have indoor plumbing. A distance behind the home stood a small building situated over a 6-foot deep hole. Inside, along with various spiders, wasps, and other creepy crawlies, you would find a bench with two holes, one for bigger bottoms and one for smaller ones. And there was no Charmin. On the bench lay an old Sears catalog. And don't you dare use those yellow pages. They were softer and were reserved for dead coons. You can imagine how unpleasant these facilities could be, especially on a hot summer day. Now, Mad Mary, that was her sister, was always after Grace. Sometimes she made up stories just to get Grace in trouble. One summer, when Grace was 10 or 11 years old, Mary whispered something to her dad that made him decide to teach the little SOB a lesson. Grace was sentenced to clean the outhouse, and she did not just have to sweep away cobwebs and replace the Sears catalog. She had to empty the pit below the outhouse. So with shovel and wheelbarrow, Grace spent the day digging and hauling filth to the orchard. Grace never found out what she had done wrong, but she didn't dare ask. Okay, next one, please. This is where they listened to the radio and the window was open, so the bats came in and hung out, slept there during the day. And next one, and I think I'll read this one. After listening to those scary stories, the Green Lantern and some of those old radio shows, they would have to go to bed in the dark. And this was Grace's nightmare. And I think that guy haunted her even through her adult life. This is the cattywampus. Grace's days were often filled with nightmarish events, and at night she dealt with nightmares of a different kind. After listening to scary stories on the radio, Grace would climb the stairs to her room. Her bed was next to the door to the attic, the only thing between her and the cattywampus. And what might that be? The most terrible, awful creature on the face of the earth, known to snack on sleeping children. Although Grace left that attic long ago, the spirit of the cattywampus has haunted her dreams throughout her adult life. Next, this is one where she was pitching hay and didn't do it to suit her dad. and bears the scars to this day because she couldn't get the hay to the top of the wagon. Picking strawberries, she was a good berry picker. She picked all day long with the promise of getting a certain amount of money. Didn't happen.
But he got all of the...
He got all the berries. Oh, sure, he got all the berries. Yes, he did. And he sold them, and she thinks she picked 5,000 quarts that summer. And I believe her. She was a hard worker. They did get to use some in their ice cream. There we go. And one of the things when I was first drawing this and came up with the character, and I showed my mom, she said, "Look how cute I was. I wonder why they didn't like me." So, and I don't know why they didn't either, but they didn't. Okay, this one I'll read. This will give you an idea too. This is a tough one. Out on a limb. Grace, along with some of her siblings and cousins, were picking dewberries near the house. They were laughing and teasing as they picked. One of the cousins dared Grace to climb a nearby tree and yell like Tarzan. She quickly accepted the challenge, perched high on the strong branch she let out with her best jungle cry. So as she's looking back toward the house, the sun glinted off something, and she saw it was the shotgun being carried by her father. And they all hunted. They all had guns. Everybody, you know, that was the way of life. But he was carrying his shotgun toward the tree as he crossed the yard. She watched as he raised the gun to his shoulder, aiming directly at her. She felt the buckshot before she heard the blast. She rejoined the others quickly as possible, not wanting to give him time to fire again. Today, she still carries a souvenir. She has a BB lodged under her scalp. That was something I didn't know. That was news when I was doing these stories. I had no idea that that had happened or that she still had a BB. Okay. This was where they got their milk, the neighbor's cow. They didn't have their own. And here's poor Fred. Fred suffered quite a bit at the hand of their dad. And he spent some time actually living in the corn shock to stay away from the house. Okay, and I'll read this one. This is Charlie and my mom up in the tree. Grace's younger brother, Charlie, had also fallen victim to their father's rages, as they all had. Feeling especially sorry for themselves, Grace and Charlie climbed a tall tree to contemplate their lot in life. Looking out over the fields, they saw no way out. Jumping to their death seemed to be the only option. As they discussed their idea, a thought occurred to them. We might not die. And they realized if they should live, they would most likely receive another beating, a fate they feared more than death. They climbed down and went home. Now, the older kids, you know, when I was doing this, the older kids remembered most of this, but some of the younger ones, because there was a huge difference in age from the oldest to the youngest, the younger ones did not remember my grandfather being like that. Some of them even thought he was very generous and kind. I didn't really know the really violent man. And so maybe as he aged, he mellowed. I don't know. But he did change as he got older. Okay, this next one, this is how they spent their time, playing with bumblebees. There wasn't a lot to do. Most of their time was spent working. So they didn't have a lot of time to play, but one of the things they did was catch bumblebees, and I learned that the ones with the white heads don't sting, in case you're interested, if you ever want to catch a bumblebee. Find one with a white head.
Oh. If you can take the time to allow the time to do that.
I know. Oh, and this was one of her jobs. She hated this job, but her dad would take a nap, and she had to keep the flies away from him. Well, Jordan's doing a good job, isn't he? This is the frog pond. There was near the house that they would spend some time there. So that must have been pretty important that she would mention that. So I think she probably went there quite a bit to escape some of the goings on in the house. And I'll read the one about fishing. They did a lot of fishing, hunting and fishing. And I think they went every weekend, if I remember. Oh, there, I should read my book. It says it right there. Often on the weekend, the family would spend the day at Po Valley, where a small spring-fed lake had formed behind a dam built by men who were part of the CCC, a program created by FDR in his New Deal initiative. Mom Coons would pack a lunch of potato salad, chips, and baked beans with watermelon for dessert. When they arrived, one of the Coons kids carefully placed the watermelon in the ice-cold water to be chilled. Some thought the water came from an underground ice cave. The dam was a good place to fish, and Dad Coons was a good fisherman. While he caught fish for their supper, the kids explored the woods and played in the water, being very careful not to get in Dad's way or scare the fish. So as I was doing this, a lot of my stories are kind of dark. And so I would show them to my mom, and she would say, well, you should write some good stories. And I said, well, then tell me some. So this was one that was pretty good. I think it probably, at any moment, it could have turned bad, but for the most part, it was pretty good. And this one, I don't think I'm going to tell you much about that one, but you can see that that was just a humiliating, sad time for my mom. She had one younger brother who had... I don't think he had polio. I think he just was born with club feet or something. And he had to wear braces, so he didn't walk well. And she had to take care of him. She didn't resent it, though, which kind of surprised me, because it was a lot of work, but she did not resent taking care of him. And this is my favorite. This is my favorite story of all. This one I called The Gospel According to Sears Roebuck. The area around Grace's home was home to many Mennonites, Amish and Mennonites. And the Mennonites invited the Coons kids to church. Dad Coons gave his permission, but they could not wear their shoes, and they could not bring money for offering. Grace eagerly looked forward to Sunday. One day, she responded to the Holy Spirit's voice and accepted Jesus as her Savior. Grace was troubled when the pastor explained that it was very important to read the Bible every day. Grace did not have a Bible. Knowing the risk she was taking, and this part, I can't believe she even did this, Grace decided to sneak into Dad Coon's bedroom after he had fallen asleep and take money from his pants pocket. After three nights, she had three dimes and a very guilty conscience. On the fourth night, she sneaked in one more time to return the money. As she went back to her room, she heard a voice. "Go to the kitchen. There's a book on the table." Grace tiptoed down the stairs. She lit the lantern, and on the table, she saw the Sears catalog. As she picked it up, the large book fell open to pages where Bibles were being offered for sale. Next to each picture was a Bible verse. For the next year, the Sears catalog became Grace's Bible. So each one, they were showing the font in the catalog, and that's what she read. And after a year, the church gave her a Bible. But that's my favorite. She said she's heard voices three times. This was the first one. She heard once she smelled smoke in our house, and she couldn't find it, but something was burning. She couldn't find it. And she heard a voice saying, I forget which one it was, "Go to somebody's bedroom," one of the boys' bedrooms. So she went upstairs, and they had a lamp with a blanket thrown over it, and it was smoldering, you know, so it was about to catch on. And the third time was pretty recent. She has arthritis, a lot of pain, and she was just really suffering with it. And she heard, "Eat beets, red beets." So she got herself some red beets, and the next morning her hands worked better. It turns out red beets are real good for you. Those are the three times. There's Jasper. Jasper was a runt. He wasn't supposed to be named, because Jasper became the main course when he got big enough. And this is coon hunting. My grandfather had redbone coon hounds. Can't see the coon hound there in that picture, but he had coon hounds, and they would go out, and then they'd sell the furs, and my mom would go to carry the lantern. And some of my relatives still raise coon hounds, so it must be in the genes. That's not one I really want, but. And sledding down the hill, barely missing the barbed wire fence. It was on the side of a mountain, James. Small mountain, but it was a mountain. And they did come down pretty fast, just missing the barbed wire fence. And it's just a few things where kind of shows that, I don't know, odd sense of humor. I don't know if this is a sense of humor or not, but my grandfather liked to sort of harass them, I guess you would say. And this is his idea of fun. That didn't happen very often. So I guess maybe they were glad for what it was. We doing okay, James?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm doing fine.
Okay. This is one she told me to put in because it was a good memory. Every year they got an Easter basket. They didn't get anything all year, but for some reason he liked to give them Easter baskets.
But nothing in it?
Yes, it had things in it. Yes, it actually did have things in it. And this is Mike. If you remember, I talked about Mary. Mary was the oldest daughter and did not like my mom at all and caused all kinds of trouble. And Mary had a child that she didn't really take care of. And so my mom did. And she was probably, she might have been about 12. But she had full responsibility, and she did resent this one, probably because Mary was his mother. But she did what she was told to do. And this one I'll read. This is kind of a nice one. Feed bag dresses. The summer before Grace's sophomore year, she found herself with not a single dress to wear when school started. Grace missed 2 weeks of school. Finally, her mother asked Dad Coon's sister, Mary Hearn, if she had a dress that Grace could borrow. She had two that she was willing to loan. At that time, chicken feed came in cotton bags printed with colorful flower patterns. Many people used these bags to make clothing. Mom Coons had one empty bag, which was not big enough for a dress. The second bag, which was needed to make the dress, was still filled with cracked corn. Grace anxiously waited for the flock to empty the bag, and when they did, Mom Coons made the prettiest dress Grace had ever owned. It was white with pink flowers. It had a wide waistband and it tied in the back. She returned the borrowed dresses and proudly went to school wearing her new feed bag dress. I actually have worn feed bag dresses myself and have a few of the feed bags at home. I haven't done anything with them, but that was pretty common. This one, her first interview for her job. And so she went for the interview, and the only condition that he gave to hire her was that she had to wear shoes. She went barefoot to the interview. So she had to come up with a way to get shoes before she could go to work. And I have one more. Is that good?
Yeah.
Okay. So she did go to work, I think it was in the cannery at first. And then she got a job at McCrory's 5 and 10. Usually she had to walk there. And it's probably 8 to 10 miles. I think sometimes she was able to get a ride if somebody was going that way, but a lot of times she had to walk. There again, I should have read my book. It says right there what she did. Grace worked at the cannery the rest of the summer. In the fall, she was hired to work in the pot and pan department at McCrory's 5 and 10. Wearing her one dress, and her cannery shoes, she nervously began her first day on the job. As she made her way to her department, she noticed a beautiful woman walking toward her. Grace continued down the aisle, and the woman kept getting closer. Grace was beginning to get uncomfortable. She looked at the floor, avoiding eye contact. A quick peek revealed that the stranger was now directly in front of her. And not only that, but she was wearing a dress identical to Grace's dress. Grace came to an abrupt stop. She stared in bewilderment as she saw herself for the first time in a full-length mirror. So she, in her yearbook, she was voted most likely to win Miss America. And she had no idea how pretty she was until she saw this stranger. That all they had was, they had a little mirror about this big that my grandfather used to shave. So it was up high where he could see it, and that's the only mirror they ever had.
Didn't any of the women or the girls have?
No.
No?
No. They probably weren't allowed. You know, they just weren't allowed to have a lot of things. And, you know, they knew better than to ask. They wouldn't ask, you know, if it wasn't already there. They didn't ask for anything. So I think that's probably the last one on that.
That was the last?
That's the last story in this book.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, I'd sort of like to have you talk about the new book.
Oh, the new book.
That you're in the process of cultivating.
Yes. So the new book, I ended this one because it was just kind of getting away from me. And so stories of my mom and dad and, you know, us kids, they started coming, but I had to stop it somewhere. So this seemed to be a good spot where she had graduated high school and now, you know, was doing more adult things. So the new book starts with how she met my dad. My dad, from maybe not when she saw him, but from my memory, Dad was a Mr. Clean lookalike. He was very muscular. Did a lot of manual labor, so he had a lot of muscles, and she saw him while she was riding with a friend who delivered milk. And she saw him working in his white t-shirt with his biceps, and that was it. The rest is history, as they say. So there were a lot of changes once she married my dad. They moved in with his parents, my other grandparents. They had a huge house, almost hotel-size house, that had a store in it, and the train ran past, and she would feed the people on the train. So there was this whole, almost like a complex. And one of the first pictures, I don't think I gave you that one, but when she married my dad and went to live at my grandmother's house, they had a half of the house to themselves, a lot of room. She had never been in a bathtub. They had no bathtub in her house whenever she was growing up. So she never was in one. So when she came out from taking a bath, my dad said, "Well, what'd you think?" She said, "Well, it was okay, but it kept hitting my head on those things." And Nancy just made fun of her because she was sitting in it backwards and she kept banging. Oh, there it is. There it is. She kept banging her head on the faucet. So that was... what do I have next, Jordan? Oh, so then the babies started coming.
Yeah.
Yeah, that one. I think you have that one. Yeah. There's that one. And being pregnant did not slow her down. My dad first I think he got a carpenter's certification through the mail somehow, and found blueprints on the back of a calendar. And they built the house from these blueprints that were on the back of a calendar. And my mom, it's a brick house, and she carried bricks in a 5-gallon bucket and 8-9 months pregnant. And at one point, I think maybe that was with me, she fell in a hole while she was carrying the bricks. And I think she broke her hip bones. I'll have to ask her about that, but I think that was me. There was something that this 5-gallon bucket fell on her, but she kept going. She just kept going.
Now that's, is this?
Oh, that's my family. I don't know. Oh, there I am. Okay. So you can see we end up with 6 kids. I'm the one, second from the right. I was the second oldest. And there are 3 boys and 3 girls. And the last 2 are twins. One looks like mom and one looks like dad. And the one brother called them the red twin and the green twin. He couldn't remember their names. And it took me a while, too, to remember their names. I just called them baby. But one was the red twin and one was the green twin. And... So there were 6 of us, and that looks like that would have been on our way to church. There was a little church just maybe 100 yards from our house, and we walked to church every Sunday.
What are you going to call this book? What is the title of it? Are you still in a transition?
I am. I thought about resilient grace. Persistent grace, unending grace. I don't know. I don't know. So I'm open to suggestions on that one. But something to say, she just never gave up. She just never gave up. It didn't matter. And it was a completely different situation than what she grew up in, but it was still hard. It was still hard. We didn't have a lot of money. My dad was self-employed, and he was not real good at collecting money from people that owed him money. So things were tough. Mom always had half an acre garden. We raised chickens. We raised beef. She had a couple cows. So we always ate. But other than that, things were tough. She had to work hard to keep us all alive. So, yeah. And some of the stories, that one is, I don't know. What do I have next, Jordan? Do I have
the tree.
Yeah, that one. That is my brother's idea of humor. The 2 younger brothers were only about a year apart, and they were always getting into trouble. And this was their idea of a joke on my mom. So there's a cherry tree out in the front yard, and the one brother, John, that's John, standing there beside my mom. He comes running in the kitchen, "Mom, Mom, hurry, hurry, Mike needs help." And she goes out, and it appears that Mike is hanging from the cherry tree. But they put the rope under his arm, so he was perfectly fine. But then she made them cut a switch off the tree. So that cherry tree did end up hurting their behinds, if nothing else. And they deserved it. I just want to go on record saying they deserved it. Do you have another one there? Or, either one. This, the one with
reading the book.
Oh, here, this is, okay, Jordan has this one up. This is something that we did to entertain ourselves. That would be our house in the background. And there was a dirt road that ran behind the house. And people dumped everything back there. That we didn't have trash trucks, so that was the dump. And we just loved to go to the dump. And we would read the Weekly World News with all their crazy stories, and we would sometimes find some toys, and, you know, but we'd usually go every couple weeks, we'd go to the dump and see what we could find.
That's also an example of what people do in Kutztown when the students are leaving. Everything is cleaned out.
Trash
and everybody
day.
Is
yeah.
On know,
the
because
sidewalk.
It's surprising
that
I think was a vacuum cleaner that one lady had, and she went by on the in the alley an exact replica of her vacuum cleaner, and she took it home with her, and she found out that the problem was that they didn't change the bag. That was all that was wrong with it. But I mean,
yeah, you can find treasures out there, treasures to be had, yes, for sure. Could I show a picture of my mom? Jordan, can you show? There she is. That's my mom. That was probably around when she graduated high school. She had long.
Is it from a photograph or?
That's a photograph.
You were around.
No, that's a photograph. And I just want to say tomorrow is her birthday, so I want to say happy birthday, Mom. I'll give you a call tomorrow. She'll be 91 tomorrow. So, yep. Okay. Do you want to? What else did I have there? Oh, there she is. There she is. That was from this Christmas. And she's holding her little dog, Bella. So she's still at home. My brother got her all dressed up for her Christmas picture. So she's doing well. Oh, there she is. So that is more probably what she would have looked like in these stories. That's Charlie. He's a little young there, so maybe a couple years from there would have been when the tree incident happened. Now, there are very few pictures of them. But this was during the Depression. She was born in 1930. So a lot of people had it rough then. You know, a lot of people had it rough, but I don't know. I feel like hers was a little rougher than others. But regardless of the way she grew up, she's just a wonderful, kind person. Nothing like her dad at all. Not at all. And we all love her.
Do you have a third book?
A third?
Yeah.
No, I don't have a third.
Oh, I thought maybe you were doing some dreaming.
Well, I might have to start on the grandkids one of these days. Because I'm working on the brothers and my brothers and sisters now, so maybe I'll have to start doing grandkids. Or I could do my husband and his buddy Woody have some really crazy stories from fishing. That might make a good book. I could fill a book with some of their escapades.
Oh.
But I don't know about the family. The family's kind of getting out of hand now. There's too many of them to narrow it down. But
the I would thank you very much for
well, thank you for having
this.
Me. I enjoyed it.
It's
thank you.
You are very good at you're talking about your book and that.
Well, it's easy to talk about
the right,
my mom.
You have the right idea.
Yeah, thanks.
And I would also like to remind our audience that the New Arts Program will be having an opening of an exhibition on the 15th of January, which runs through the last part of April. And it's a show of 48 artists from Haiti. And if you've never know or you don't know too much about Haiti, it is an incredible country. They actually had a democratic government before we sort of in a way had one here. It didn't last long, but they rose the poverty-stricken slaves, rebelled, and in from about 1800 to 1804, they took over. But they not only have problems with government, but they also have problems with hurricanes. And I always am surprised because they're on an island. The Dominican Republic is the bigger part of the island. Mm-hmm. And they're on the eastern part. And Haiti is a very small, it's like an open mouth, but it's not very wide. Mm-hmm. And one is brought up as Spanish and the other as French. They can't get along. Isn't that strange? I mean, it's horrible. And because people can't, that are there, they want them to get out.
Right.
And but it's there's about 140, 150 works of many of different sizes.
I've seen a lot of them. They're amazing.
And so when you can, you have, should wear a mask.
Mm-hmm.
But you just come in, knock on the door. I'm there 7 days a week. Usually I get there somewhere around 6:30, and I'm there until about usually until about 1 or 1, 2 o'clock. If the door's locked, you just knock on it. On Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, it is open from 11 to 3 each day. So take a joy ride and come by. I would like to thank you again, Joan.
Thank you, James.
And I would like to thank the audience for tuning in. I'm James Carroll, and good night. See how simple it was?
Was it?
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.